All right, fantastic. So Paul gave us a lot of food for thought to build a great conversation on. But before we do that, I want to give you a little context so you know who else you have up here on stage. So Luke, if you could go first and just do a quick 1 minute intro to give some context about sort of why you're here on this panel today and where you came from.
All right. I'm Luc, Luc Billion. I'm from Belgium. I work in a company that is dealing with a lot of development and platform as a service type things for the federal government in Belgium, actually. Where we started from was about 3-4 years ago when we were under a lot of pressure from the Belgian government to reduce costs, to get a lot more economics in, I think what most federal governments do in that area. So we tried to get some synergies out there to find out where we could best get onto things, and now we decided to go basically on the open source world. Looking at different things, working with OpenStack, working with OpenShift, working with new database type things, and that's where we got into Postgres as well. So I guess that's where it started.
All right, excellent, Luke, thank you. I think you got to know Paul a bit already, so we'll go ahead and skip to Eddie.
Sure, so I have a couple roles. So I have my own startup and I'm a co-founder of that, working around the data platform side, as well as currently I'm working with IAG, which is the largest insurer in Australia. It's a conglomeration of a number of different Australian insurers into one large company, which means lots of organic growth and lots of disparate data sources, none of which were really ever brought together prior to kind of an effort that started last year. And I came on board for that. So I've been helping them design kind of the new way to do data warehousing to get to the intelligence piece, which is not just to build another siloed legacy architecture, whether it be Data Vault or Star or whatever, but get rid of that and move to a system that enables analytics, which Paul was just talking about a bit. So that's what I've been doing recently.
Awesome, Eddie. Thank you very much. And Adam.
Hi, Adam Kukulowski. I'm Paul's colleague at IBM. About 10 years ago, I started a company that was operating in the sort of nascent NoSQL space. I was one of the authors of CouchDB. And I think, you know, in that project, we looked to Postgres time and again as sort of the, can I say spirit animal? Like the intellectual forebear in the world of the database space that we wanted to try to learn a lot of lessons from and that seemed to hold the right kinds of ideals that we wanted to provide in a database. And have certainly lived that whole transition as people have sort of taken ideas back and forth and have been really excited to see a lot of the enhancements coming in the world of Postgres that expand its aperture and new applications. We built that database into a cloud service that was acquired by IBM, and over the past 3 years, my responsibilities have sort of evolved to encompass the delivery of all of our database and analytics services in the IBM cloud, which now, of course, over the past couple of years includes Postgres as a service.
Excellent, Adam. Thank you very much. Now, I've got a lot of questions for this panel and actually a number that I made up just as I was sitting listening to Paul as well, but I'm sure you do too. So I want to see where the mic is in the audience because I'm going to open it up to you actually pretty early. I'd love for you to raise your hand, give me an indication that you've got a question, and we'll get you into this conversation too. But while we're finding that mic, let's actually go back to the end here to Luke. And so did I hear correctly that you're involved with the government as well? And there was some discussion this morning around sort of public-private partnership and different things like that. I want to understand why, how do you, in that type of sort of sensitive environment, how do you choose to go open source? What made you, what are the key things for making that decision?
Well, the key things were basically, a bit of pressure from our government to actually see we want to get some added value to the public, to the civilians, and everything around it. So we're going to have to focus on that one, but we want to stick to the same budgets. So it's basically all driven by budget rules. Decreasing infrastructure, decreasing budget on infrastructure and platforms as such, while we had to go forward as well with the new technologies. and everything around it. So that made us initially invest to actually gain money afterwards and to make money afterwards. I think I saw that up on the screen as well earlier. So and that's where we went from. So it's not a long program that we run so far. It's been not longer than 3 to 4 years so far. Slowly but steadily, we're getting there. People are asking why in a governmental organization, which is not known to be the most innovative or something like that, why do you go with that? I think there's no other way around it. So we just have to do it that way. We have to go to the open world, working with the community as such, but not deploying just the open source. We want to go enterprise, and that's what we really want to get into and then get further. So we do have a vision around that.
You know, I just add to that for a second. From the things that I've seen, is that so for sure that that's the spend money to save money we talked about in the open source, but open source isn't free, right? You know, I got a free puppy about a month ago, and I can tell you, it's not free, right?
Absolutely not.
But it's definitely the cost savings opportunity. I showed you that example with Postgres. But on top of it was the agility, and Adam, you would know a lot about this from when you were on the Cloudyn days. It's the agility and the delivery of new function feature benefit in a fast manner. When I was in the DB2 lab back in the day, we'd update in Oros. Every 2 years, we'd do an update. And like, think about your experience on your mobile app today. You get updates all the time. And so being able to deliver new features that can further cut costs or do more efficiencies, I think, is another key thing that often gets forgotten. I think it's even bigger for open source.
Sure. When you talk about companies doing like a digital transformation,
yeah,
right?
Exactly.
A lot of the analysts are going to be talking about, you know, this world of multimodal IT, multi-speed IT. And on the one hand, you're spending money to save money to harden your operational systems. And Postgres has a role to play there. And on the other hand, you're trying to encourage new business opportunities by building new applications. And increasingly, we're seeing folks turn to open source data management technologies in that side of it. So I really, it's sort of uniquely positioned at the center of this kind of transformation for companies. Yeah.
And specifically, from the IG perspective, had nothing to do with cost whatsoever, right? It's all about capability. So for them, you know, sure, it went from 23 warehouses down to 11 now as they consolidated across companies. But it's more about getting capability to be able to curate the data, as you talked about, and to be able to look across disparate companies that were all part of one conglomerate now through organic growth, and be able to understand what does this mean across all companies that are all in insurance, but all very different products.
Yeah.
And how do I understand what a claim is and what a policy is at the basics, but then above that, how do I understand the details from a supply chain and a repair perspective? How do I understand that next level down, which is very, very difficult with a lot of the commercial tools that were used in the past. Is much, much easier and enabled by an ecosystem of tools around the open source community.
And yeah, you hit it, community. It's like collaborators out there to work on problems, be them technical, be them business, that you can relate to. So I think that's neat.
It gives the people from your organization as well the opportunity to work with people in the community as such, which is a big thing for them as well. They like to do innovative stuff, whereas they don't want to be, you know, held to whatever your supplier gives you. Yeah. So that was a big decision for us as well, to go for that one. Yep.
Yeah, and it was a recruiting tool. It doesn't hurt either.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, nobody wanted to come work for, you know, the data team at IAG 2 years ago. And now we've hired 4 new data engineers in the last couple weeks, and people are actually reaching out to our recruiting team, going through the data engineering posts that are on the career site just to get in, because we're doing this stuff with open source, and it's all around open source tools. And hey, we'll let you commit back too, right? It's okay.
Paul, I'm still sitting here thinking puppy. Millennial, who has...
I hate them both.
So let's talk a little bit about the buzzword I always hear at these types of conferences around privacy.
Okay.
And sort of, you didn't really go too much into that in your presentation. Sort of, what are sort of key things? Be mindful there.
Yeah, I think there's overlooked this privacy thing. People always look at it for regulatory compliance. And I may have mentioned it, but I say that regulatory compliance, people always do the least effort to comply. You know, if I don't get this, I'm gonna get fined. And so if you think about GDPR in Europe, that's a big, big thing today and has big fines today. So people are coalescing around that. What I will just beg everyone to do is to get an organization to step back and think about, how do I get privacy in terms of allowing for the speed of insights, right? That will be your path to insights. And from a personal perspective, everybody in the room, I just ask everyone to remember, if you're not paying for the service, you're the product being sold. You're not the customer, right? If you're on Gmail, yeah, they just said, we're not going to scan your email accounts to add you. Why? Because they've been doing it for tens of millions of people for a heck of a long time. They've already built those profiles. When you upload your pictures to Google, that's what they're using that to training and label data. If you're on Twitter, Facebook, you name it. If you're using it and you don't pay for it, you're the product being sold. So there's kind of three angles of privacy there. But I want everyone to focus on the privacy for insights. It goes a long way.
You know, something we've been trying to tease out and explore a little bit is in the world of data governance, right? You've got this whole portfolio about defining policies for data management at a very high level and you know, what can be done with the data, what has to be redacted, how it can be used, and even, you know, down to the data subjects, right? Data about individuals. And then on the other hand, you've got fine-grained access controls in the database. And the two don't really talk to one another all that often, right? And I'm kind of curious to see over the next coming years, as things like GDPR really take shape and drive some changes in the technology industry, whether we will start to see a little bit more of an interrelationship where it's possible to define policies at a high level that your CDO can understand and be able to push down some of that logic into the access control layer in the database. I don't know. I think it would be a stronger posture than what we're able to accomplish today.
Security by intent,
yes.
Right?
Right.
Kind of, yeah.
Luke, you're leaning in. Did you want to add to that?
Well, we're very much confronted with that, of course. I mean, we do have a deadline, which is April next year, to get everything in order. So, which is, it's going really well. That's the only thing I can say. No, I mean, there's a little bit of, I mean, a little bit, no. There's a lot of paranoia around the whole thing also. It's overshooted. It's really a little bit overdone. There's many, many, many solutions out there that can help you out. Build an environment in your databases, in your data warehouse, that you have secure data, that people can't get to it and things like that. So encryption, and these type of things. They're all the whole thing. It's also a matter of defining your data. Your data classification is part of the whole thing. And if you're into that one, there you go. I mean, no worries. I mean, yes, in the beginning, there was this big fines they were talking about. We've been 6 months into the whole game right now. Nobody's talking about the fines anymore. Everybody's talking about, let's be pragmatic.
Yeah. Well, you hit it there by talking about the metadata.
Yeah.
It'll all be about the metadata. Look, when I was 8 and my mom made me go clean up my room, I didn't like it. I saw no benefit. But today, when I tell my daughter to, I see that benefit. I know she knows where stuff is. You got to know where your data is. You got to know where it came from. You got to know what transformations happened to it. Who's the steward of that data? Those things will just completely open up your analytics aperture. So.
Well, one of the biggest things for us was getting a master data management solution in place that was actually able to capture the metadata and to tag and flag data, because it's super interesting in the database layer to secure a transaction, and you've got to have those policies like you talked about. But when you start talking about insights-driven stuff, when you're looking at your customer or you're looking at an insured vehicle, an insured property, or a property risk profile across an area based on weather and storm patterns, like all those things, you can't really do fine-grained access control and make that work, right? I mean, there's zero chance. So that's why we started using more of the open source stuff and move that stuff out into a NoSQL data store and then into search using the Solr framework, right? And then being able to push that out to call center staff and others to be able to then use that Lucene index bit from Solr to be able to then make it available for type ahead and you know, other things in pre-populating forms, right? So if you put that fine-grained access control on that, it would break completely and you'd get no value out of the insight side of it, and the reduction in call handling time and all those things that you get as a save money bit are an accident based on the fact that I actually want to find insights in this data.
Completely agree as a today statement, right?
Yeah.
But what happens if you do go to the database layer right now? Is it default open?
No, it's all locked down.
It's all locked down. Yeah. So then the only way through is to sort of delegate access to the thing that understands the policies.
Yeah, or to, you know, basically write reports and static operational stuff against the data store that is a defined access pattern. So if I want to do my business operational reporting, obviously that's still for IG is delivered through Tableau from a database, which is EDB at the base layer, right? And then the nice green plum fun, more Postgres in a different way. but I mean, that's how operational reporting is delivered and derived. But when you talk about what people are actually doing to provide insights, they don't use any of that. Like, that's how I run my business today. When I want to actually figure out what I'm going to do with my business tomorrow, completely different platform.
You know, though, and you talk about the future. Now think about in this Internet of Things, and you have these DAOs, distributed autonomous organizations, this data's flying in 24/7 coming in. what do I do with that data as I look at it? Because in some countries, in some divisions, if I store that data, now I have a rule that I have to store for 11 years, and I have defensible destruction and the costs associated with storing data. So as data flies across, we also want to be aware of, where's this data stream coming from, or I'm grabbing an open data API, and do I want to store this? Do I want to land this on my premises and then take ownership of its sovereignty? Or do I just want to analyze it on the stream as it comes across and find some interesting things about it, never actually storing it? So this is very broad reaching in the future.
I sort of want to vote for that. Now, I think I saw the microphone come in. So do I have any questions yet here? Percolating. All right, wake up, people. We're going to then change to a different trend. And I want to talk about blockchain, although I want to ask you a question out here first. Who's implementing blockchain? So not that many people. Are you interested in blockchain? We want to talk about a different thing. Not that interested in blockchain.
Two or three people, eh?
Yeah. Okay, the millennials.
Right now, every hand should be up, right?
Thank you, Paul.
Yeah,
I would agree. Tell them why.
Yeah, and then... I mean, Adam, you know more about this than I do, but I'm going to tell you this. Blockchain will do to trust and transactions what the, or to trust what the internet did to transactions. Everyone hears blockchain, they think of that's Bitcoin stuff. Toss that out the window. Blockchain is a distributed trust mechanism, and that will change the way every business works. It will disrupt finance with fintech, although finance companies are looking at blockchain to kind of streamline things. Like, for example, why does a stock trade take 3 days to settle? In blockchain, it should be instant. The other day, I applied for a credit card. I have two mortgages with this bank, and yet I had to go and give them all the information again. So that's going to make people run faster, but the trust will disrupt businesses. So a company like Western Union, for example, a money transfer pay, like we pay people to distribute trust between brokers. We pay banks, governments, and intermediaries like PayPal or Western Union to transfer money to Africa or something. Those folks will be out of business. You know, you think about food and food safety and traceability. And the movement of people buying food and millennials is not just traceability, it's transparency. So farm to fork, but then what were the processes? How are the pork shipped and how are they fed and how are they transported to the slaughterhouse, was it humane? People are going to want to know all that. It's on the blockchain. And the way they'll track diamonds is on the blockchain. So think of it as a distributed trust agent, but maybe you can kind of add to that.
Well, I think the other use case that's been pretty interesting, right, is logistics. You know,
yeah.
You see shipping industries,
yeah,
right,
like
where the paperwork holds up the container on the dock and the fruit's rotting inside and whatnot, right?
Yeah.
You know, there's a degree of certainty around, you know, at least some of the blockchain work that I think has a potential to make a big, big difference there.
Only because there were only three hands. If that's the biggest advice I could give you folks today, is to go and learn a little bit more about blockchain, because half the audience's hands should have been up.
We're using it. We started to use it in a pilot to exchange data in the health sector as such.
Right.
So we're working with hospitals in Belgium. We're working with private organizations that do stuff in medical care and in health security and insurance and stuff like that as well. So and that's like slowly but gradually building up. And what you mentioned is it's just to do about trusted parties and third party trusting, which is a big deal in that one. But it looks good.
And
absolutely.
I can connect it back a little bit to the privacy conversation from before. IG is also doing a POC in the space around sharing claims data specifically for fraud and risk between insurers across the ANZ region, right? So being able to pull across all this data and share it in a way that doesn't violate the various privacy agreements that are necessary in the area to have with your own clients, but as well across borders. And it's being worked on with different government regulatory agencies to make sure that it complies with everything and that they're doing it. However, there is still some, on the other side of that, there's still some infancy in the blockchain being able to be adopted.
Yeah.
And the reason probably, in my opinion, two or three hands went up is because there's still a pretty large barrier to entry for getting into something that really is gonna be a meaningful project in this space. And you know, 2 years from now, I don't disagree that maybe it can be there. Today, it's maybe a little hard.
Yeah, no, I agree. This is, you know, it's coming super fast. You know, it's not too late. I think there's an old Wayne Gretzky hockey saying where you go to where the puck is going to be, not where it is.
Mm-hmm.
It's hard for me to talk hockey in Boston being from Toronto and that bullshit. But anyways, that's the kind of stuff that you have to be thinking about. But for sure.
I think it's still early days for the whole thing, but Everything started with early days as well.
Yeah, great point. So. Great point.
Yeah, absolutely. Adam, what keeps you up at night?
What keeps me up at night? running a 24/7 cloud service more often than not. I think that we are, you know, as someone who's supposed to be responsible for technical strategy, right? Like, that role is starting to feel a little frayed sometimes because the number of spaces in which technology is moving much, much faster than you're accustomed to is increasing, right? So to try to be able to sort of articulate intelligently when something is a blockchain transaction compared to a database transaction that's running three orders of magnitude faster, right? To be able to sort of articulate, you know, the sort of data preparation pipelines that are useful for the world of artificial intelligence and sort of, blend that with what you traditionally think of as the world of ETL, right? We're seeing these things converge, but I think everyone knows things are changing, but there are fewer and fewer people who have a clear idea of what the world's gonna be like 3 years in advance.
Eddie, what keeps you up at night?
Well, what kept me up last night was, deploying a whole new environment. just being able to balance the fact that a lot of the legacy of the data world, you have to keep that stuff running and you can't kill that while trying to do everything new. And, new is great and fast and, with our framework, we can deploy an entire environment in 20, 30 minutes, but then you actually have to make everything work. Yep. Right? And you have to hook it back into all the legacy systems to integrate everything together. So even, like I was talking about earlier with the IOG, the new platform to do the insights work still relies on the EDB layer underneath to get source data from transactional systems. So being able to build the new one is awesome and that all works great, and then I have to make it actually work with all the old way and the old systems and the old kind of transactional data sets. It takes a considerable amount of extra effort.
Paul?
I have a 12-year-old who's going to turn into a teenager next month. That keeps me up at night. But from a business perspective, I think this goes back to what Adam said, just how fast the landscape is changing, how do I keep up? It's really hard. And I've been in the industry a long time. It's impossible. And so you have to, what I find is surround yourself with communities of people that are smarter than you and teach you. Adam's taught me a ton, but I love that Postgres Rocks community forum. I went to join it during the presentation because then now I know a place where I can go and tap a community of experts. And that would be the best advice to you is understand that the world is changing so fast that you can't keep up, and it's all going to be about the communities that you participate in to get you smarter and faster. So Postgres Rocks, right?
Postgres Rocks, I love that.
Luke. I love the title, so.
What keeps you up at night?
My grandchildren.
Yeah.
When they're around in the house. No, I mean, just kidding a bit. But what keeps me up at night is basically the fact that we're transitioning from the environments we're in at to where we're going to. Basically because they're not really mature yet, and we are dealing with an operational environment as well. We are to be up 24/7. Pretty high SLA, 99.99. So big stuff, especially in the health sector. It's all about the citizen who needs his application and who need their applications to actually get to what they need to. Go to a pharmacist, system doesn't work, you don't get your medicine. So that's kind of the examples that we're running into, and it doesn't keep me really up at night, but it's worrying sometimes.
Great. Question here. Marcy's got the mic.
Is it on? Okay. Everybody talks about real-time insights, data mining. Then everybody talks about the operational systems and the need for different and legacy and reports and all that. If we look a year down the road, they've got to merge together, right? How do you see, what building blocks should we be putting in place today to be ready for a merged world of legacy and data mining and real-time insights?
I'll take this one first, if it's okay.
Yeah.
So, interestingly enough, from an IG perspective, we are going to, in the next month or so, open source a project we've been working on to basically build in a Python Kafka-based framework for doing real-time data ingestion from legacy sources as well as new sources. So we're using a lot of stuff that's already been built in the community. Again, back to the community thing, and we're pulling in a lot of various modules that have been built in Python by other companies, some in the high-tech space, that so we can build a framework that lets you, instead of doing ETL the old way, is even as we're pulling source data from the system, to be able to write it via Kafka to multiple destinations. So we'll write it to a transactional database for the things that are transactional, but we can write the rest of the data right to the Cassandra store that we're using for the customer insight system. So starting to look at things as a pipeline of data and turning everything, whether it's a legacy ETL style transactional system or whether it's something new and different, trying to treat it all as a message stream and treat everything as a real-time piece of data, whether I use it today as a real-time source or whether I just need it to say, oh, look, I sold 10 things yesterday. I'm expecting to sell 9. Why did I only sell, those sort of things. You can still get that part out of it and go that direction, but if you start to treat every message and every transaction as an event rather than think of it all as just a database bit, it becomes a little more interesting. So
I do think we're seeing a lot more people reimagine data sets as data feeds. On the other end of the spectrum, you've got some folks saying, we're going to see a lot more analytics get pushed into the operational systems, and that is true, but I think it's a very specific kind of analytic routine that you can execute, in the context of a transaction. It's certainly not going to be some sort of grand unified convergence where all of a sudden you don't need data warehouses anymore because you can do all the analytics in the transactional systems. I really do think this approach that you're talking about, of a data streaming, data feeds model is a lot more flexible and adaptable to, changes in technology.
And coming from an insurance company currently, right, that they've had a lot of that for ages, right? SaaS is in pipeline doing stuff around risk analysis and underwriting decisions and those sort of things. So they've been pushing analytics towards transactional systems for ages, but it's still a very limited part of what the insights you get, right? And no insights really come out of that. You just get pricing and things that customers aren't happy about.
Right.
They just do it because they don't have a choice. You want to make customers happy, that's different.
Yeah, and Adam, I think you hit on head, and it goes back to what I talked about earlier. Not one thing will replace everything. So you'll see that pattern emerge and more in a real-time insights. But data warehouses aren't going to go away. They'll be domain specific. You hear a lot about things like HTAP. And I'm just trying to think of each of the vendors, whether it's Oracle, SQL Server, if I think under the covers, they're really taking a row store for the transaction and then conditioning it into a column store for the warehousing aspect of it. And when you think about discovery and analytics, that's on a whole corpus of data.
Yeah.
Quite frankly, you won't be able to do discovery like that on the streaming transaction, on the data, and then you want to go to that breadth of it to do deep neural networks and learning. So that's a pattern. It's an emerging pattern and getting bigger. And so to specifically answer your question, it's having that adaptability and agility around the technologies, whether it's Kafka, whether it's streams or Storm, and then leveraging things like Object Store and those types of things, I think will help you.
All right, we have time for one more question. We have that right there.
Hi, thank you. My name is George Pop, and I came from Singapore, and I was very glad to hear in Ed's presentation making a reference to the bank I used to work for. I'm one of those financial services technologists. My question is specifically to how do you see Postgres or EDB in the space of data as a service? So in our experience, we got used to, when we talk about databases, typically we associate it with a platform like Oracle or MS SQL or DB2, et cetera. And now we are learning that open source technologies like Postgres can also can come in and help us in our digital transformation. Ultimately, our technology teams, in a bank, for example, we don't want to care about what database technologies we use, whether it be Hadoop or Postgres. We would just like to use data services. How do you see the industry evolving to allow us indeed to focus on the data itself and not on the database platform behind it?
I think it's certainly correct that a lot of folks are adopting more of a microservices architecture in some of these new applications too, right? Where there is a service API that is abstracting away the direct database connections. And then it comes down to, well, what kinds of constraints? Do you have relational data? Do you have constraints on, relationships between these records that require you to have a certain degree of transactional isolation in the system? And does that need to be a part of the service contract? And if it does, then it's hard to imagine a better choice for net new development than Postgres is today. I think you do see some other services that you know, anticipate operating at a large multi-tenant scale and say, well, I just need a very simple key value storage system. And in that case, there are systems that have a more sort of well-defined scalability profile. So, you know, as Paul said, it's not the matter that one size is going to sort of take on everything.
And I think to the data as a service, like it's a very overloaded term, but in the manner that you're using it, you're right. Like, do you care what the technology is? I care about the ubiquity of the API. Is it flexible? Can I be very expressive around that API? And I think Ed's keynote hit it on the head into these, what did he say, micro to mini services or one way or the other. That's what you'll see, and maybe it's a RESTful invocation, and this is what I want to do. And when I build that Node.js application, that's exactly what I did. I had a discrete API that would get a tweet. I had a discrete API that would store data in Cloudin. I could have done it in something else. I had a discrete API that called a visual recognition service. So if you think about when SOA was so hot, think about that. It's all these little discrete pieces, and that's how we'll put that stuff together. Whether I persist data, and I thought you hit it on the head too, is what are the isolation semantics that I need, right? Do I need high concurrency, repeatable read type stuff? Or is it schema, I'll worry about it later, that's a bitbucket? I'll call the API, and I think the cool thing on the Postgres is just the multimodality of that is incredibly flexible. So call the API to score a document, call the API to do a key value store, because I'm doing golden mile optimization, right, and web surfing, and then call this one with high isolation levels because I need real data and I need it hardened with ACID properties. So that's how you would front it.
Great. So what I'd like to know next and last for this panel, pretend that we're here 3 years from now. So Postgres Vision 2020. You thinking about that?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Luke, what do you hope you'll be talking about?
I'd be talking about AI, automation intelligence, because I think that's a very important one. I mean, you get more efficient by automating your basic principles, by building up your basic infrastructure and automating the whole stuff around it to get more efficiency in whatever you do want to deploy and whatever you want to build up with.
Excellent.
That's
Paul,
basically what it is.
Perfect. Paul, what's your prediction?
I'm invited back, I hope. We'll start with that one. I think we're back here and we're talking about a lot of the same things that we're talking about today. We're talking about governance. We're talking about data mining, artificial intelligence, although we'll all be more conversational and deeper, like the algorithms will be leading the way. We'll all understand that. We'll all have recruitment problems to get the right talent there. Mm-hmm. And we'll all be trying to keep stuff uptime and wondering where the last 3 years went and how did it go by so fast. So that's what we'll be doing.
Eddie?
Yeah. So I think we'll, like you said, keep a lot of the same conversations will be going on. It'll be an evolutionary discussion. I don't think in this space there's a huge, you know, revolution coming in the next 3 years. I think it'll be an evolutionary discussion. There'll be a lot of incremental changes. There'll be a lot of ability of platforms like Postgres to be able to take on more data capability to deal with more things. There'll be ideally a lot less tools that have to go up on the board when people do presentations. We won't have to talk about the 50 different ways you can do something, but we'll talk about the 5 ways you can do something because people will have, you know, made some decisions and we'll stop talking about things that don't matter. And, you know, we'll have kind of a more consolidated approach of this is how you solve a certain set of data problems, not from a database perspective because that just happens and is easy and it's all solved, but that we'll be talking about how do you do actual intelligent things with that data once you get it.
That was a good wish list. Adam, you had the most time to think.
Yeah. So on the topic of intelligence, 2 things I'm curious about. I don't know if we'll see them in 3 years.
Uh-huh.
Turning the intelligence on the internals of the database, you know, smarter query planners potentially that are learning from, you know, more and more executions in a way that you know, traditionally we have done rudimentary work in. But I think you could start to see more smart machine learning stuff applied in that space. And then on the sort of API side, I feel like this has been 3 years out for a very long time, but conversational access to databases, not for your application developers, but for your analysts, for the reporting, right? People have tried a number of times to put sort of a conversational API to do an NLP to SQL translation layer, and you know, my understanding is we keep hovering around 50 to 60% in terms of getting the right SQL right, you know, and that's clearly not good enough for anything more than like exploratory work. But I do think with all of the emphasis being put on conversational systems as a way for you to converse with your customers today, some of that innovation is going to bleed back into the database layer at some point.
Excellent. All right, Adam, you had the last word. Thank you so much. So thank you so much to this panel. Great conversation.